Praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you very much. We know you are a good God. We love you, Lord, and we know you love us much more. We're praying, Lord, that your love will work mightily in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Bless your people tonight again. In Jesus' name we pray. Keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true. Keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be true. Keep me filled, keep me filled, Lord Jesus, keep me filled. Keep me filled, Lord Jesus, keep me filled. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be filled. Keep me skilled. Keep me skilled, keep me skilled, Lord Jesus, keep me skilled. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be skilled. Keep me true. Keep me true, keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be true. Amen. You can sit down, please. This time we're looking at another picture of biblical leadership. And we're looking at the spokesman. We're looking at the spokesman. That is, the Christian leader has a message to communicate. And he must be a spokesman for the Lord. In Exodus chapter 4, reading verses 15 and 16. Exodus chapter 4. Verses 15 and 16. And thou shalt speak unto him, and put words in his mouth. And I will be with thy mouth, and with his mouth, and will teach you what ye shall do. And he shall be thy spokesman unto the people. And he shall be, and he shall be, even he shall be to thee instead of a mouth. And thou shalt be to him instead of God. I'm sure you know this passage very well. There's a time the Lord was encouraging Moses. And was encouraging Moses to go to the land of Egypt. That he will actually speak to Pharaoh. But he said he didn't have the knowledge. Neither did he have the eloquence. Or the ability or the skill to speak to Pharaoh. And then the Lord said, I'm giving you Aaron. And Aaron will be your spokesman. You will hear the word from my mouth. And then you will give the word to him, because he will be instead of a mouth for you. If we're going to understand this very well, we understand that Jesus came into this world. And he has a message for the whole world. The Father gave him what he would say. And now he has appointed us to be a spokesman. And part of our leadership is that we will speak in the name of the Lord, and we will speak instead of the Lord. We are the mouthpiece of the Lord, and we are his spokesmen, spokeswomen, spokesladies. The Christian leader has no message of his own. He is God's spokesman or Christ's spokesman. Neither Moses nor Aaron, neither Samuel nor Elijah, neither Jeremiah nor Ezekiel had any personal message to convey. They were all God's spokesmen. In Ezekiel, reading chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Ezekiel chapter 2. In Ezekiel chapter 2, looking at verse 7. And thou shalt speak my words unto them. In other words, you'll be my spokesman. You have no message of your own. You have no words of your own that you are going to speak, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, for they are most rebellious. And in verse 8, but thou, son of man, hear what I say unto thee. Be not thou rebellious like the rebellious house. Open thy mouth and eat what I give thee. Again, emphasizing the fact that we as leaders in the church were God's spokesmen. In chapter 3 of Ezekiel, I'm reading to you from verse 4. Let's read from verse 1. It says, moreover, he said unto me, son of man, eat that thou findest, eat this roll, and go speak unto the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he caused me to eat that roll. And he said unto me, son of man, cause thy belly to eat, fill thy bowels with this roll that I give thee. Then did I eat it, and it was in my mouth as honey for sweetness. And he said unto me, son of man, go, get thee unto the house of Israel, and speak my words. Ezekiel, not your words, speak my words unto them. This tells us beyond any shadow of doubt that we as leaders, and we as the prophets of God, and we as the proclaimers of the gospel of the kingdom, that we are actually the spokesmen of the Lord. And you will speak the word of the Lord unto them. In Matthew chapter 10, Matthew chapter 10, we're reading from verse 27. Matthew chapter 10, verse 27. What I tell you in darkness, that speak in the light. And what ye hear in the ear, that preach ye upon the housetops. All these references convince us that as we move out and we minister and officiate in the ministry or in the position of a Christian leader, we're actually going out as spokesmen of the Lord. We know that the Lord has the message, the ultimate message, the final message, and the important message, the essential message, the indispensable message, the message of life, and the message that will bring the very life of God into the hearts of the people, will give them life eternal. And now we have been chosen by the Lord, and you're wondering, what am I going to tell them? Don't worry about that. I will give you the word. I'll touch your mouth. I'll put the word in your mouth, and then you will declare unto them the very words and the mind of the Lord. Even Peter, Paul, or any other New Testament communicator has no personal or private idea or private principle or private information to deliver to the people. All those people in the New Testament were also Christ's spokesmen. The leader is a spokesman, and he communicates God's word to the church as well as to the world. Let's come back to Ezekiel chapter 3. There is something that is very instructive in the ministry of Ezekiel and in the way that the Lord dealt with Ezekiel. Actually, what the Lord told him. And this will be very important as we get into the ministry of the spokesman, of the person that the Lord himself has chosen to speak on his behalf, to give the people the word of the Lord. Let us look at it from verse 5. I've read to you from verse 4. From verse 5 now, for thou art not saying to a people of a strange speech, of a hard language, but to the house of Israel. The Lord was saying, I'm sending you to your own nation. I'm not sending you to foreigners that you don't understand their culture, or you don't understand their language, but I'm sending you to the people of Israel. Not to many people of a strange speech, of a hard language, whose words thou canst not understand. Surely, had I sent thee to them, they would have hearkened unto thee. Let's remember once again the difference between the ministry of Jeremiah and the ministry of Ezekiel. Ezekiel was sent to his own nation, was sent to his own people, was sent to Israel. In the case of Jeremiah, the Lord said, I've appointed you a prophet over the nations and over the kingdoms, and you are going to throw down and pull down. You are going to root out, and then you are going to plant, and you are going to build. And the Lord was saying, Ezekiel, I'm sending you to your own nation. Know the limits of your ministry. Know the confines of your ministry. Know the territory of your ministry. By the way, Ezekiel, if I had sent you to another nation, if I had sent you to a foreign nation, they would have hearkened unto you too. Only that this is my will for you and this is my ministry for you. But the house of Israel will not hearken unto thee. For they will not hearken unto me. For all the house of Israel are impudent and hard-hearted. Well, Lord, why are you still sending me to them? Since you know they are not going to hear. That's not your business. I am the final authority, the creator and the supreme one and the great king of heaven. Even though I know the end from the beginning, that they will be saved or they will not be saved, they will respond or not respond, they will react favorably or they will react negatively, that's not your business. I'm sending you to them. Do you understand then, when the Lord has sent us to a place and we say this is hard ground, they're not listening, they're not yielding, they're not responding, and you do not have the liberty to say, I will not speak to them anymore, because the Lord had sent you there. In verse 8, behold, I've made thy face strong against their faces, and their forehead strong against their foreheads. There's something I've discovered. When God sends you to a difficult place, he also gives you a tough mind. When God sends you to a place where they themselves, their foreheads like the flint, like a stone, and they are hard-hearted, the Lord sends you there and he gives you to you a very strong mind, a very courageous mind. I want you to watch the various ministers that you have known before. When they were in easy circumstances and easy situations, they were like people that couldn't endure anything. And then God picks them up and he sends them to a people that they are impudent and hard-hearted. All of a sudden he gets to that situation, and as he gets there, he becomes a tough person. And then he comes back home here during a planning meeting, and then he's sharing testimony, and he said, this is happening there, this is happening there, and these people are after us, but all the same, I've made up my mind, I'm going to be there. And then you try to recollect. I used to know this brother when he was a region of Asa in Nigeria, state of Asa in Nigeria, and he wasn't a strong type, he wasn't the courageous type. He was a person that you might even say wasn't, like a Caleb or like a Joshua, a warrior. But now he gets to this place and it's a strong mind and a tough mind. And so what is happening? Because of the place the Lord has sent him to, the Lord is matching the minister with the ministry. And the Lord is making him to have a bold mind, a courageous mind, a tenacious. He becomes a tenacious person and is preaching the word of God. Then you cannot run him down or send him back. That's exactly what God did for Ezekiel. As an adamant, harder than flint have I made thy forehead. Fear them not, neither be dismayed at their looks, though they be rebellious as. Moreover, he said unto me, son of man, all my words that I shall speak unto thee, receive in thine heart, and hear with thy ears, because you are God's spokesman. And therefore the word I'm speaking to you, you'll hear it with your ear, you'll receive it in your mind, and then you'll give it to them and go. Get thee to them of the captivity unto the children of thy people, and speak unto them, and tell them, thus says the Lord God. Whether they will hear, whether they will forbear, that's not your business. That's not any of the things you should be thinking about. Then the Spirit took me up, and I heard behind me a voice of a great rushing, saying, blessed be the glory of the Lord. From his place, I heard also the noise of the wings of the living creatures that touched one another, and the noise of the wheels over against them, and a noise of a great rushing. So the Spirit lifted me up and took me away, and I went in the bitterness, I went in the fervency, in the heat of my spirit, but the hand of the Lord was strong upon me. Then I came to them of the captivity of Tel Abib, that dwelt by the river Kebar, and I sat where they sat, and remained there astonished among them 7 days. When the Lord has sent you to the people, go and stay with them, go and live with them, and sit where they sit, and stand where they stand, and eat the food they eat, and dress like they dress, and do the things that they do, so that you'll fit in, you'll become part of them. And it came to pass at the end of 7 days that the Lord, that the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth, and give them warning from me. That's what you have to do, Ezekiel, because you are a watchman over the people. And then I give you my word, and then you give the word to them. You're my spokesman. Look at verse 26. And I will make thy tongue cleave to the roof of thy mouth, that thou shalt be dumb, and shall not be to them a reprover, for they are a rebellious house. Verse 27. But when I speak with thee, I will open thy mouth. The spokesman of the Lord, when I do not give you a message, I'm going to shut up your mouth. When you do not have any message from me, I'm going to make the tongue of the roof of thy mouth, your tongue, to cleave to the top of your mouth, and you will be like a dumb person, because I've not given you any message. But when I give you a message, then I will open thy mouth, and thou shalt say unto me, unto them, thus says the Lord God, he that heareth, let him hear. He that forbeareth, let him forbear, for they are a rebellious house. We're learning something about who leaders are. Leaders are spokesmen, and the spokesmen of the Lord. And when the Lord gives you a message to give to the people, he opens your mouth, and he gives you clarity, and he gives you the skill to communicate what he has given to you. But when he has not spoken to you, then he keeps you, he shuts you up. What do we learn from that? It is not every day that a preacher preaches. What are we learning from that? It may not even be in every program that a preacher preaches. What are we learning here? It may not be in every discussion that a leader opens his mouth and then he says something. If God has not given him something to say, he doesn't force himself. He doesn't say, I am going to speak now. You are God's spokesman. And when he has not given you a message, he shuts up your mouth. And therefore, you are not embarrassed. Here we are, for example, maybe in this planning meeting, God has not given you a message, and therefore you are not speaking. There's nothing wrong with that. When God has not given you a message, he shuts up your mouth. And you do not force yourself and say, I must say something. How can we come 2-3 days in a place like this, and then I will not say something? Of course, I must say something. No, you don't have to. When he shuts you up, praise the Lord, you're still God's spokesman. And then when a message comes now that you are to deliver this message to the people of God, he opens you up and you deliver the message. We are communicators, as spokesmen, as leaders in the church. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, the communicator's pattern as a spokesman leader. The communicator's pattern as a spokesman leader. Number two, the communicator's power as a spokesman leader. The communicator's power as a spokesman leader. Then number three, the communicator's purpose and perception. Purpose and perception as a spokesman leader. We come to number one, the communicator's pattern as a spokesman. Obviously, we remember the Lord Jesus Christ as our master, as our Lord, as our pattern. In John chapter 12 verses 49 and 50, John chapter 12 verses 49 and 50, for I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say and what I should speak. Even the Lord Jesus Christ recognized that he didn't have any message of his own to present to the people. But the Father had sent him. And the Father did not only send him, the Father sent him with a message. And he declares here before his own disciples. Can we declare that before our own followers, before members of the church? I don't have any message of my own. I'm sent. I'm a saint man. And it is what the Lord has given me, that is what I'm going to declare. It says, my Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say and what I should speak. In verse 50, and I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so speak I. As the Father said unto me, so speak I. Actually, that had been recorded since the Old Testament time in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. The Lord had looked forward to the time that the Lord Jesus Christ will come. And he had decided that this will be the way we're going to play the game. If we speak in our own language, this is the way in which we're going to carry out the mission. I'm going to send my only begotten son. And then he's going to be my spokesman. He's going to be the communicator of the Father's heart. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, I will raise them up a prophet, capital P, from among their brethren, like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth. I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. He shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And that's our pattern. The Lord Jesus Christ, as a spokesman, telling us and revealing to us the mind of the Father and the message of the Father, communicating what the Father actually had in mind to communicate. That is the pattern for us. That is the model for us. And so as we go to minister in our various locations, whether we're ministering as an evangelist, or we're ministering as a teacher, or as a pastor, or we're ministering as an apostle or a prophet, we're going to declare the mind of God and the word of God, the message of God to the people. And that will tell you then that although cultures may change, the message does not change. Although traditions may change, the message does not change. Why? Because God changes not. I am God, I change not. And God does not change with culture. And God does not change with tradition. And God does not change from nation to nation. What God is in one nation, that's what God is in another nation. And the message of life, the message of the gospel, does not change from program to program. It is still the same message, and therefore you are receiving from the Father, and you are giving unto the people. That's exactly what Jesus did. If we understand that, then we're not changing from location to location. We're not changing from year to year or from one period to another. And we say, we used to preach it this way. This is what we're preaching now. Well, what we're preaching now will still be the word of the Father. The word of the Father. He gives it to us, and then we give to the people because we're God's spokesmen. We're looking at John chapter 7. Still looking at Jesus Christ as our pattern. Looking at Jesus Christ as the one that has modeled the ministry for us. In John chapter 7, looking at it from verse 16. Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. My doctrine is not mine. You begin to think about the doctrines of the Lord Jesus Christ, the repentance and the restitution and the righteousness and the salvation and the conversion and the sanctification and everything that he said. My doctrine is not mine, but it belongs to him that sent me. We understand then, as we go out to preach, we're not trying to modify the message, and we're not trying to kind of adjust it to suit the people or to suit the culture and the tradition in which we are, because this thing does not belong to us. We're God's spokesman. We receive from the Father, we receive from God, and we give to the people. Verse 17, if any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. In verse 18, he that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. Jesus said, I'm not here to seek for my own glory, or to seek for my own honor, or to promote myself, or to exalt myself. I'm a saint one. The Father sent me, and I'm conscious of that all the time. And the Father that sent me is with me. And because he sent me, and because he's with me, I want to do the things that are pleasing to him all the time. And one of the things I'll do pleasing to him is to speak his word and not seek my own glory. That verse 18 again, he that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. But he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness in him. In John chapter 8, verse 26, John 8, verse 26, I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true. And I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. Many times you couldn't miss it, because he repeated it many times. He said it many times. He assured the people, as well as assured his own disciples many times, the words you are hearing from me, the teaching you are hearing from me, is not mine, but the Father sent me. and he gave me the word I should speak. Whether I am speaking to the world, I'm speaking to my own disciples, as he has told me, as he has taught me, even so am I speaking. Chapter 14 of John. In John chapter 14, we're looking at verse 10. John chapter 14, verse 10. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. Our ministries will never please the Lord until we come to this mindset of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our ministries will never bear the fruit he taught to bear until we come to this attitude of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our ministry will never make the progress he taught to make until we commit ourselves and we consecrate ourselves and we submit ourselves, and all those personal ideas and the personal things, policies that we like, and the thing we like so much, we want to talk about every time, but it's not in the word of God, until we're able to sacrifice them, give them up, throw them to the winds, because they have no value at all. Until we make a commitment before the Lord, every time I open my mouth, everything, every time I speak, I'm going to speak the word of the Lord. And it doesn't matter the composition of the congregation. They may be highly placed people, they may be rural people, they may be peasants, they may be men, they may be women, they may be young people, they may be children. Whenever I open my mouth, I'm going to declare, thus says the Lord, the word of the Lord. I'm getting to understand that I'm God's spokesman. And I'm not to give my ideas to the people, my opinions to the people, my feelings to the people. You know, there are people that will say, I feel that I'm going to cut that off. I think that I'm going to cut that off. As for me, if you ask me what I want to say, you want to cut that off. You want to cut off anything that is personal. And you want to go to the word of God. And you want to the Spirit of God to breathe upon that word. And then to lead you in the direction that you ought to go. And the things that you ought to say. Jesus said in that verse 10, the words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. We're looking at verse 24 of that same chapter 14, verse 24. He that loveth me keepeth, and he that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings. And the words which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. Is the Father that sent me, and is the Father that has given me the word that I speak. Chapter 17, verse 8. John chapter 17, we're looking at verse 8. In John chapter 17, verse 8, for I have given them the words which thou givest me. Here, it was talking of the believers. It was talking of his own disciples. It was talking of these chosen men, the servants of God, that became the apostles of the Lord. And then he testified, already has told us, the words he spoke to the world, he got that from the Father. And the ones he spoke to his own disciples too, to the apostles too, he got everything from the Father. I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. They have believed that you actually sent me, and all the things I spoke as you gave me. An effective leader then must be an effective communicator. To mobilize followers and to ensure change and transformation is virtually impossible without the ability to communicate values and vision. And as you look at the Lord Jesus Christ, it was very, very different from the scribes and from the Pharisees, because he preached for change. He preached for transformation. There are people, you remember in one of the series, I think when I started, I spoke to you the very first message on leadership, when I was talking about the leader as a shepherd. And I told you there are, in our preaching, there is information. In our preaching, there is instruction. In our preaching, there is inspiration. In our preaching, there is interpretation. In our preaching, there is illumination. But in our preaching, there is impartation. And it is when you bring everything together and you impart something to them, and there is life you are imparting to them, there is a change, there is a transformation, that the people that have had the word, they are not remaining the same. They are becoming different. They become different in their hearts. They become different in their attitude. They become different in their worldview. They become different in their virtues. They become different in their values. In the value they place on material things, earthly things, heavenly things, they become different in their values. They become different in their vision. And so we understand that if we're preaching as the Lord wants us to preach, if we're preaching and communicating the mind of the Father and the message of the Father, and we want to fulfill the mission of the Father, then we're going to be a change agent. And we're preaching to ensure change and to ensure transformation, so that then the values and the visions of the people will change. And Jesus was a consummate leader. He was also the peerless communicator. He appeared in a number of different speaking roles, and his style shows remarkable flexibility. If you will look at the speaking style of the Lord Jesus Christ, you will see when he was speaking to the rural people, you'll see what he said and how he said it. When he was speaking to the Herodians and those Pharisees and the Sadducees, they wanted to catch him in his word, and were talking about something related to politics. Should we pay tribute to Caesar? He took another approach. And now he was going to be in the synagogue and was going to talk to them too, because they were selling things in the synagogue. And he took a whip and drove them out, and then he quoted scripture. Would you notice that on the field he didn't quote scripture? Would you notice that when he was talking to the rural people, he used simple illustrations, and you know those illustrations, those parables. And then when he now came to his own disciples, this is what was written, and now this is the fulfillment of what was written. You see the different levels at which he spoke when he communicated the mind of the Father to the people, addressing the crowd, addressing his opponents. Whenever he addressed the opponents, if a lawyer will look at the answers that Jesus gave to his opponents, he spoke like a skillful lawyer. And then when counseling individuals, when denouncing those hypocritical religious Pharisees and leaders, you'll see the way that he spoke. And then when it comes to declaring future realities, that's in prophecy, he spoke like a prophet, instructing his own disciples, pleading with tears like a great lover, weeping over Jerusalem. He moved men's hearts and minds by his speech. And if you will look at the speech of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you look at Jesus Christ as a communicator, and see the way he communicated the message, then we have quite a lot to learn from the Lord Jesus Christ. And let's look at the conclusion of the message, the Sermon on the Mount, and see the attitude of the people, the response of the people, the reaction of the people when he finished that Sermon on the Mount. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 28 and 29. Matthew chapter 7, verse 28, verse 29. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. When actually you are speaking the word of God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and you're not adding your own opinion, you're not saying I feel. And even when Jesus said, they said before, but I say unto you, he was standing in the authority of the Father, because he was declaring the mind of the Father. And when he finished, they said, this is authority, this is power, this, nobody can hear this and remain neutral. When you hear this, you have to do something, you have to move, because his message called for change. And as you come to John chapter 7, verses 45 and 46. John chapter 7, verses 45 and 46. Then came the officers to the chief priests and Pharisees, and they said unto him, why have ye not brought him? The officers answered, never man speak like this. You know the implication? You Pharisees that sent us, we have heard you many times. And you politicians or religious political people that sent us, we've heard you many times. So can we tell you something? We have gone to hear that man just once. And never man, whether Pharisee or Sadducee, never man, whether Herodian or Zealot, never man spoke like this man. Were they affected? Yes, they were affected. When Jesus spoke, were people affected? Yes, they were affected. Even when you didn't know they were affected. Let me show you an example. You remember Nicodemus came to him by night and then asked him something. And then when he said what he said, Jesus spoke to him. As you read John chapter 3 and you see the conversation and the message of Jesus Christ, you might think, that is one case that was not effective. That's one case that although Jesus spoke to that man, there was no effect on him. You think so? Let me read on in chapter 7. In chapter 7, it says, then answered, verse 47, then answered the Pharisees, are ye also deceived? Have any of the rulers of the Pharisees believed on him? But these people who knoweth not the law are cursed. Nicodemus saith unto them, in bracket, he that came to Jesus by night, being one of them, does our Lord judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth? That man had been affected. Although when you read chapter 3 of John, you might think, did it have any impact, any effect on him? When Jesus speaks, there is impact, there is influence, and there is transformation, and there is a change. Was it a temporary change? Look at John chapter 19. In John chapter 19, we're looking at verse 39. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Even when the disciples were afraid and they all ran away and they forsook him, Nicodemus with Joseph of Arimathea then came along, and then they did the last honor to the dead body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus was a great communicator, and his communication of the message actually brought a change in the lives of the people. I come to point number two, the communicator's power as a spokesman leader. The communicator's power as a spokesman leader. Again, we're going to look at the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're going to see the change that he made, the transformation that he made. He is a model. He is a pattern. And because he is a model and pattern, we want to see the power of his word, the power of his message in the lives of those people that he communicated the gospel with. In Luke chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 47. Luke chapter 2, reading from verse 47. It's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ when he was still very young, just about the age of 12. Verse 47, and all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. They understood not the saying which he spake unto them. It was about his father's business. And in this verse 47, all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and at his answers. Can you imagine a 12-year-old person sitting among these doctors of the law, and they asking him questions, and he responding to them, and he asking them questions, and they could not respond properly? That's the Lord Jesus Christ, the wisdom of his message, the power in his message, the transforming power, the transforming influence of his message. He was a communicator with power. In Luke chapter 4, Luke chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 4. Jesus answered him, saying, it is written, that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And that's Jesus communicating, sending the message across to even the devil, to Satan. And what was the result as he continued to answer him? Then we're told in verse 13, and when the devil had ended all the temptations, he departed from him for a season. The devil couldn't continue, because whether Jesus Christ was communicating and sending the message to the Pharisees, or to the Sadducees, or to the Herodians, the politicians, or to the common people, or to his own disciples, or even to Lucifer the devil, that message was effective. He was an effective communicator. In verse 22, and all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? Everyone just marveled, and they bore witness at the gracious words coming from his mouth. He was full of grace and full of truth, full of grace and full of truth. And because
he was full of grace and full of the word of truth, then the words that came out were gracious words. We are learning all this, that we will be like him, that we'll go to the Lord in prayer and we'll ask him for more grace, so that of his fullness we'll receive again, and then ask from him more of the word of truth into our hearts, into our lives. And as he speaks the word of grace unto us, we'll be able to speak that same word of grace unto other people. As he speaks the word of truth to us, we'll be able to declare that same word of truth unto others. And then as the testimony was given about him, that his words were gracious words, so then the same testimony will be given about us, that our words are gracious words. Verse 32. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. His word was with power. The gospel shows us then the impact of the words of Jesus. His words had immediate power on the people. His words are continuing power, continuous power on the people. And his words had ultimate power on the people. And that's the kind of power words ought to have too. It will mean that from now on, we're committing ourselves to the Lord not to speak carelessly anymore. Not just to throw words here and there, but to be very thoughtful like Jesus, to be very wise like Jesus, to be meditative like Jesus, and then to receive the word of the Lord into our spirit, into our hearts, and then to give that same word of God unto the people. If you're going to do that, the word of God will not be floating on the sea of your heart. The word of God will be going deep into your heart, and then it's mixed with your very thoughts, and it's a mix with your very attitude, until it makes a change. It's like the food you eat. It gets into you. It has been digested. It becomes a part of your body. And there's a part of that food you have eaten that is digested that never leaves. It makes up, builds up your cells. And the same thing with the word of God, that the word of God gets to us, mixes with our mind, with our thoughts, with our spirit, and then everything internally is changed. Internally is changed. And then we give that word of grace unto the people. And let's look at the words of Jesus again in John chapter 3. In John chapter 3, in verse 1, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. A ruler of the Jews. I want to remind you that when Jesus spoke, they said, how come that this man is speaking like this, having never learnt? Having never learnt. He didn't go to the schools of the day. He didn't go to the colleges of the day. He didn't go to the seminaries of the day. And yet when these rabbis came, when these Jewish teachers came, people like Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, when they came, he spoke to them so deep that they couldn't understand. And then he had to illustrate and then make illustrations for them to even be able to grasp the meaning of the spiritual truth he was communicating to them. It is not the school of this world that is going to educate us. In fact, if there's anything we can say about the schools of this world, they mess you up. And they give you all that theology and all that heavy stuff. And when they have given you all the heavy stuff, you don't know how to find your way anymore. It's like, you know, when you take some of these commentaries, if you take some of the commentaries that, you know, actually they are heavy on Greek and they are heavy on Hebrew and they are heavy on history, and you take, you know, the pulpit commentary, for example, and you're just looking for something very simple, and you've read that passage, and then as they look at the passage, then they go to the Greek and the Hebrew, and then the illustration, and bring some historical things, and by the time you read everything, you are more confused than before you even got started. But in the case of the Lord Jesus Christ, all that heavy stuff was not there. Have you noticed that the Lord Jesus Christ never corrected the text of the Old Testament? Never. He'll just say, as it is written, and then he says it, and then he applies it to the people. Have you noticed that some of those commentaries, you know what they will do? They will say, this is the text. Then they will try, instead of just, you know, giving you the word, they're busy trying to correct the text. And they say, you know, you have to be critical. There is now a modern scholarship. And because of the scholarship, they have to correct this and tilt it this way, and tilt it this way. And then they bring some definitions of some words. After bringing those definitions, and then you match them with the word of God that you are reading, you find that they have taken the very heart and the very meat and the very meaning and the punch of that message, of that passage, they've taken it away from you. And that's the reason why you just come back to the Lord Jesus Christ and say, Jesus, What would you have said about this passage?
What would you give me about this passage? I want to be a spokesman, not of the commentary, a spokesman, not of those authorities. I want to be a spokesman of the Lord himself, because he has appointed you to be a leader. He is the one you are representing, and you want to get the word from him and then give to the people. Let's go on. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, teacher, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Let's look up here for a moment. We're learning, and since we're here so that the Lord can get the best, make the best out of us, and it will happen in Jesus' name. You know I want a great amen.
Amen.
You know me now. You know I'll not keep quiet if you don't give me good amen. You know, sometimes a person is developing, and as this person is developing, before he even goes to any seminary, he's praying for the sick and they're getting up, and blind eyes are being opened, and then the lame people, they are walking, and he's serving the gifts of the Spirit, word of knowledge and word of wisdom, and the gift of faith is doing some dynamic great things. And then somebody called him and said, you know what, God has called you, and this is something great in your life. Can I advise you? Anything worth doing is worth doing well. I hear you. And what's your advice? I think that if you really know that this is what God has called you to, go to seminary. You know, this other one is there, this one is there, this one is there. Would you understand? After that man has gone for 3 years and he sat in that classroom for 3 years, and they give him Greek, and they give him Hebrew, and they give him interpretation, and they give him sermon preparation, and they give him all the things they want to give him, by the end of 3 years, he comes back. Is he still able to work the miracles he worked before he went to seminary? No, never. He cannot do that again. His messages, do those messages have the same punch and the same power that they had 3 years ago before he went to seminary? Never. It never happens that way. I've been watching all those people that were effective, that were dynamic, and they were firebrands before they went to seminary. And then after coming back from seminary, and they have read this and read this and read that, by the time they come back, now they can talk in a very organized manner, in a very stated manner, you know, how to stand, how to use body language, how to look, how to open the Bible like this. You don't open, you have to get trained how you open the Bible to, how you open the Bible like this, and then how you read, and then when you read, how you pronounce those words. That's all they tell them. If a person had been very prayerful before he went to seminary, you know, prayerful like Elijah, like Charles G. Finney, and then he goes to seminary for 3 years and he comes back, and after he comes back and his people say, our minister has come back. He used to be a great prayer warrior, and now he has gone to seminary for 3 years. Now we're going to have prayer meeting. Let him lead prayer. I'm telling you, they are going to be disappointed. When the man comes back, they have messed him up, and they have cooled him down. And the interpretation, all those things they have given him, has really spoiled him. I'm telling you something. Let us be careful in our IBTC. It's good to have knowledge, and it's good to have all these interpretations and everything that we need. But make sure that all those people coming to that IBTC, we don't cool them down, we don't kill them and bury them, and then send them back to the churches. If it does that, like the seminaries of all the other denominations are doing, then there is no value anymore. We're destroying them. Ministry. If they come in with fire, let him go out with fire. And if he comes in with zeal, let him go out with zeal. If he comes in as a firebrand, let us make sure that after he has come to that Bible school and he goes out, he still remains a firebrand of the Lord. And you'll find, but you know, the seminary of the Lord Jesus Christ is very different. When he called Peter and James and John and the rest of them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men, the way he interpreted Bible to them, the way he demonstrated the message to them, and the way he showed them, exemplified, illustrated the things that they ought to do, by the end of their training, he said, you are not ready yet. It's not certificate, it is power. It is not the paper you hold in your hand, it is the power of the Holy Ghost. Wait in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high, because I tell you that you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days since. And you remember they were waiting, 120 of them out of 500, and while they were waiting and praying, as they were sitting, the Holy Ghost came upon them. them. And it is this Peter that rose up and said, men and brethren, listen to me, these are not drunk. And he picked the scriptures right there. This is what was written by Joel, interpreted it to them. By the time he finished, men and brethren, what shall we do? Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus, and then you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You see, when they found, when it came out of the Bible school that Jesus gave them, they became firebrands. And the zeal they didn't have before, and the power they didn't have before, they had that power. Let us make sure that whatever seminary we're going, and whatever commentaries we're reading, and whatever books we're reading, the fire still remains. If you know you're reading some books and your fire is going out, throw the book away. Anything that will take the fire away from you, that will take the unction away from you, that will take the anointing away from you, that will take the effectiveness you used to have. Because, you know, here we are, some of us that have never gone to any seminary, by the Lord bringing us up and training us up and, you know, doing everything for us, we come on the pulpit like this. They might say it's zeal without knowledge, but people are getting born again. They might say we don't know how to interpret the Bible, but people are getting sanctified, and lives are being changed, and converts have been made, and they're coming into the kingdom. Make sure that whatever book you are reading and whatever thing you are listening to is not making you to go down, it's still lifting you up. And by the grace of God, I'm very, very selective in the things I read. If I'm reading something and I see that this one will kill me, this one will remove my fire, and this one will just take the very nucleus of what I have, the essence of what I have, the power that I have, if it's going to take it away from me, I don't care how much I spent on that book, I throw it away. I said, this will not help me at all. And I want you to do the same thing once you are seeing that the thing is not helping you. But now, the Lord Jesus Christ, in his communication, he communicated the message and he communicated the power of God. And Nicodemus came and he said, we've been watching you. All of us, we know. Even though all of us may not confess it publicly, but we know that you are a teacher come from God. Because no man can do miracles like this that you are doing except God be with him. Jesus answered and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Do you see Jesus as a communicator who can go from miracle that you are doing, and the praise that he's giving you, and the very fact that he recognizes your authority and your power and the miracles you are giving, and go from that, from verse 2, and go to verse 3 and talk about being born again, and change the topic, and talk about the essential thing, and talk about the indispensable thing, about what it means to know the Lord and to be born again? Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born again when he's old? You know what I discovered? If you're a good communicator and somebody comes to you and this is the topic that he actually wants to go on discussing, he wants to talk about miracle, he wants to talk about healing, he wants to talk about deliverance, and then he starts the conversation, we have been watching you and we thank God for your ministry, and nobody can do these miracles that you're doing except God be with him. If you have a message from God and you know this is not the time to talk about miracle, we're going to talk about being born again, and then God gives you the wisdom and you're bringing that topic of being born again, the fellow who wanted to talk about miracle, he forgets what he wanted to talk about, because your message brings a change, it brings a transformation. Then the man now continues with the vein that Jesus Christ brought up. How can one be born when he's old? Do you know there are people that control the conversation? And if you are a counselor, if you are a teacher, if you are a pastor, and people come to you, you might discover some people that they just want to control the conversation, and they want to tell you the topic we ought to discuss about, and it is this, and it is this, and it is this. And many of us will forget ourselves. It's exactly what they are talking about. We pick that up and we continue to talk about that. Not the Lord Jesus Christ. He got his message from the Father, and the message this time is being born again. And then can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. That's direct. That's direct. I will say it's confrontational. And you see, when you are speaking to people, the Lord will direct you as to the method you are to use. Whether you are to use indirect method or you are to use a direct method. And then he said, the wind bloweth where it listeth.
and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. I've shown you already the impact of that message on Nicodemus. Let's look at another situation. This is in the Gospel according to St. John chapter 4. John chapter 4. I'm reading to you from verse 4. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour, that's about 12 noon. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. Give me to drink. How do you start a conversation with a total stranger, a complete stranger? If you are like most people, we don't know how to start conversations. Strike a conversation with a complete stranger, somebody you have never met before, somebody you have never seen before. That's the communicator. If we are communicators, you meet a total stranger and you have a message, and it's from the Father. The Lord will show you how to start. Not only that, how do you talk to somebody that the culture, the tradition of that place forbids that you talk to that individual? Because Jesus Christ, coming from the Jewish section of society, and this Samaritan woman coming from Samaria, they had nothing to do together at all. They shouldn't even be talking. In that day and that age, for a man to be talking to a woman, that was a taboo. You didn't do that. And then for a Jewish man to be talking to a Samaritan woman, that was another sin. And yet the communicator, the Lord Jesus Christ, had to do that. And even his disciples will not understand. And when the disciples came, they were surprised that he was talking to the woman. How are you going to be a communicator of the message of the word of God? Here is a total stranger. Not only a total stranger, the culture, the tradition of the land forbids that we'll talk to this woman. That's why we're learning from the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, give me to drink. Isn't that just like an innocent statement? Is that not like a neutral statement? Would you impose religion on this on this statement? No, not at all. Is this the same the way he spoke to Nicodemus? No, not at all. Why did he speak to Nicodemus like that? Nicodemus knew the Old Testament, and Nicodemus was a religious leader. Are you a ruler among the Jews and you don't know these things? This Samaritan woman was just a village woman, or just the normal woman that didn't have all the knowledge of religion that Nicodemus said. Do you see the difference as you are communicating the word of God? That you look at the people and you communicate the word in a way they would understand, that matches their background, matches their understanding, matches their culture. And then it says in verse 8, for his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy food, to buy meat. Then said the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which I am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. What if the person you are talking to, communicating the word to, reminds you, are you ignorant of our culture? We don't do like that in our place. Men don't talk to women over here. And after all, you're even a Jew. How can you talk to me like that? For many communicators, for many leaders, that's the end of that conversation. But for us to learn from Jesus how to go from that situation, that you have stopped him right there, and then move on and still communicate what you want. And Jesus answered and said unto her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that says unto thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked him, he would have given thee living waters. Can you see Jesus is still using normal language, but he's now giving some deep meaning into that language. Living waters, that's the water of life. And the woman saith, sir, now there's a little respect now, sir, not Lord yet, not Savior yet, not the Messiah yet, just sir. And this respect, and you will see when you are communicating, in a very short time, you are able to lead the person, first of all, to accept you. first of all, to respect you. If the person you are communicating the message to does not respect you, does not put value on your personality, she's going to shut you off. He's going to shut you off. It is that respect that precedes receptivity. Receptivity, rather. Then he said, the woman said, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou this living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? And Jesus answered and said unto her, before I read that, what would you have said? Because look at this sinner. Look at this one that is moving from man to man, calling Jacob our father, saying that, you think I don't know what I'm talking about? Even Jacob our father drank from this. How would you still be able to follow your train of thoughts at this time? Or would you be diverted into another thing? Would you come to condemn her at this time? Jacob your father, I hear you. But look at what Jesus said. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. Jesus told her something she can prove, something that she knows about. You've been coming here, you've been drinking it, and you've been getting thirsty again. Whosoever drinketh of this will thirst again. I'm not going to argue about Jacob. I'm not going to argue about history. I'm not going to argue about what Jacob did and when he did it. That's not my point. And that's what Jesus was doing. He wasn't going to argue about their religion, about the basis of their religion either. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Everlasting life. Do you remember the purpose of Jesus? Why he came to the world? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He brings that everlasting life now. Do you see how slowly and little by little Jesus will say a little at a time, a little at a time, and then he will build on what he said before? He called it before living waters, but now he's talking about everlasting life. The woman says unto us, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Now, there is believability. That means Jesus spoke the word in a way that this woman, a total stranger, believed Jesus Christ and believed that this water, although she didn't understand the depth of the message, I need that water. Give me that water so that I'll not be coming up and down and will be drawing. And Jesus Christ did not quarrel about the limitation of understanding, because Jesus knew, I am moving her from where she was to where she would be. I'm going to ask you a question now. Has a change even happened at all now? Oh yes, a change has happened already. Because you know, at the beginning, say where you are, I am where I am. We don't talk together. You are Jewish, I'm a Samaritan. But now she has moved from that position of saying that you are a stranger to me, I'm a stranger to you. And she has come to the position of, I'd like to receive what you want to offer. And I want you to give me this water, so when I drink, I will not come here anymore. The pattern of the Lord Jesus Christ in communicating, a spokesman of the Father. That's what we are talking about. When you are a spokesman of the Lord, you want to move the people away from where they are to where they ought to be. And now, when you are moving people, it doesn't mean they are born again yet, but you are moving them. Somebody comes in and he knew nothing about being born again, knew nothing about a change of life, and he was even resentful about being born again, but somebody brought him to you, and now he came to the meeting, and by the time he left the meeting, he's saying, looks like this is a place I should come to. Looks like, although I've not got everything I want, I think if I keep coming here, I will get what will satisfy my life. He's not born again yet, but he has changed. There's a transformation. Because when he came in the first time, it's like, I'm just coming here to visit, and I have my own church, they have their own church. And when listening to you, and when you quoted, when you started, who is this person? He was first of all resentful and was rejecting. But later, as the message went on, it's like, looks like I can get something out of this. And looks like this will benefit me. Looks like if I have my chance, I will come again. There's a change already. At least he has come from a place of when he knew nothing, he desired nothing. There is awareness that is created now. Then he comes again, and you move him from awareness to illumination. Looks like I need a change. my life with my husband, with my wife, I don't think this is the way it ought to be. And if I'm going to really live the life I ought to live, I think I need to change. It's not born again yet, but you're moving him. You're moving him. And then he goes back home again. He comes again and he hears the word of God. It looks like I'm going to try. I will try my best. I will change. And he's struggling. He can't save himself, but there's a change, because at least now he wants to try, he wants to make an effort, he wants to change. And then he comes again and he says, I tried and failed. And that time you are talking about the grace of God, and it's just like you talk to him. You cannot change yourself, no matter how you try. This is the life of heaven, and only grace from heaven can accomplish this. And then he gets on his knees, and then he's born again. There's a total change now, and now the change has now totally fully happen. When we preach and we communicate the message unto the people, we're moving them and moving them and changing them and transforming them until the conversion actually eventually takes place. And then it says in verse 15, the woman says unto him, Sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus says unto her, Go, call thy husband and come hither. Do you remember in all this passage, where is the mention of hellfire? In this passage, where is the vocabulary adultery? In this passage, where is the vocabulary polygamy? In this message, where is the sentence that, you know, God is angry with the sinner every day? In this passage, where is, you know, the message about, except to repent, you will likewise perish? Do you know there are people in their communication, they do not have to communicate the message. And some things they must always say. Not to everybody. You can lead people to repentance and transformation and change without going through the same road and the same route every time. And when you have your purpose, the purpose is what matters, and the goal is what matters, and you're still able to go to the route, to go through this route, to be able to achieve the purpose of communicating the mind of God unto the people. Go and call your husband and then come hither. You want to drink water? This water that I have. And Jesus did not explain fully that water of life, but at least there's a desire. I want to drink that water. Okay, go and call your husband. And then the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus says unto her, Thou hast said well, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that thou hast said truly. What's this? What gift is that? Word of knowledge. He had never met the woman. Do you know there are people that think word of knowledge is only... there's somebody here, you have headache. Raise up your hand. There's somebody over here, your ankle is paining you. Raise up your hand. And there's somebody over there, the ulcer that is bothering you. And in fact, you're not able to sleep last night because you are rolling on the bed because of the stomach problem, because of the ulcer. Raise up your hand and you're going to get healed. Some people think that the word of knowledge is limited to discovering or discerning the sicknesses that are there. This is word of knowledge. And the woman said, I don't have any husband. And Jesus said, you have said truly, because you have had five husbands. How did Jesus know there were five? And not that you are not with a person, you are with a man now. And this man you are staying with now is not husband. You need even bother to go through any wedding ceremony. You are fed up with ceremony after ceremony, just packed in, and you're living together. And then the woman saith to him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. No announcement. No exaltation of himself, but I perceive you are a prophet. And since I perceive you are a prophet, I have a question for you. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye Jewish people say that in Jerusalem is a place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto a woman, believe me, believe me. Now that you know that I'm a prophet, believe me. The hour cometh when ye shall neither worship in this mountain, nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Now, you see theological terminology coming in now. This is salvation. That's the theological terminology coming in. But the hour cometh and now is when true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh. Look at this. I want you to look at the graduation. I want you to look at the progress. Now, when Jesus met her, Jesus or I was just a man of the Jews. And then as they went on, he became Sir, a word of respect. And then as the conversation, communication went on, I perceive thou art a prophet. And then you see the movement now, as the conversation, communication went on, Sir, well, I'm not going to stay with a prophet. I know the Messiah is coming, which is called the Christ. And this is a woman. And when they met together, just a few minutes ago, he was just a Jew, just a Jewish man. And when he cometh, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee, I am he. Look at the final thing. I that speaketh unto thee, I am he. Verse 28. And the woman left her water pot and went her way into the city and says unto the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? She became a communicator of the message herself. When we learn from the Lord will teach us how to be a communicator of the word. Effective communicator. I come to point number three. The communicator's purpose and perception as a spokesman leader. The communicator's purpose and perception. What was the purpose of the Lord as he communicated the message in John chapter 3 verse 17? John 3 verse 17. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Know the purpose of your preaching. Know the purpose why you're declaring the truth of the word of God. And sometimes we forget our purpose. Our thing to preach is just to preach. And then we condemn the people. And we knock the people on the head. And we're working against our purpose. Our purpose is to make them change. Our purpose is to make them love the Lord. Our purpose is to make them attached unto the Lord. Our purpose is to make them be willing to have transformation in their lives and to ask for the grace of God to come into them and to fill them and to change them completely. But when we forget our purpose, then we begin to knock the people on the head. And knocking them will not open their eyes, it will seal them up. In John chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 39. John chapter 6, verse 39. This is the Father's will which has sent me, that of all which he has given me, I should lose nothing, but I should raise him up at the last day. That's the purpose. When we are communicating the message with the church, they will have that purpose in mind. All those people who are born again, all those people who are children of God, we don't want to lose any of them. Therefore, our communication in the message, our approach in the message, and the choice of language or vocabulary in the message, even the look, even the attitude, even the posture, will show that we love the people. We want to grab them and draw them along patiently and tenderly and take them to the kingdom of God. In verse 40, this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone that seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Let's keep to the purpose that the Lord has in mind in making us the communicator of the message of life eternal. In John chapter 12, reading from verse 45, John chapter 12, verse 45. And he that seeth me seeth him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. That's the purpose. That's the purpose. We want to lead them to the Lord, that the people who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ will not abide in darkness. You are enlightening them. They are opening their spiritual eyes so that they will see what they ought to see. In John chapter 18 verse 37. Pilate therefore says unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I'm a king. To this end was I born. For this purpose was I born. For this reason was I born. For this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. That's the purpose. That we should bear witness unto the truth. If we know the purpose why we are preaching, then we're going to go that same direction. We're going to emphasize the right thing, and we're going to say it with the right tone, with the right attitude. and with the right posture, with the right body language, and with right gesticulations, we're going to say everything in line with the purpose we have in mind, the reason why we're preaching. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, reading from verse 16. Acts 26 verse 16, but rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of the things which thou hast seen, and of the things in the which I will appear unto you. The reason why you are called is that I've made you a minister, and you are ministering something to the people. And I've made you a witness, will be a witness of the things you have seen, and of the things I'll see appear to you on. In verse 17, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom I now send you. I'll be supporting you, I'll be delivering you, I'll be protecting you. Nobody will hurt you. I will be with you while you are going. What are you going to do while you go? When I send you to them, verse 18, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light. That's the purpose. That's the purpose. When you pick up the word of God, then you'll open it before the people. You open it to the people. You interpret it to the people. And you apply it on their lives, because you are opening their eyes to see the truth. And you are turning them away from darkness unto the light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. Those who are not born again, that they will know that our God is a forgiving God, and that our God will forgive their sins. And then it says, an inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. And that's the purpose. In 1 John chapter 3 verses 8 and 9. 1 John chapter 3 verses 8 and 9. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's the purpose why he came. And that's the purpose why we're preaching. That's the purpose we're communicating the gospel, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. You want to help them to see how easy it is, with the help of the Lord, with the grace of God, with the presence of God, or the power of the indwelling Christ in their hearts, how they'll live the victorious life. That is the purpose. For his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. In Matthew chapter 1 verse 21, Matthew chapter 1, reading from verse 21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. The reason why Jesus came is so that the people will be saved from their sins. And that's why he has sent us forth, that we will communicate the gospel, the message unto them. Clarity of speech comes from clarity of purpose. When you are clear in your purpose, then your speech will be very clear. Christ's person, Christ's vision, Christ's mission were all integrated with his speech. He preached and taught with authority and confidence. He ministered in the power of the Holy Spirit, and he expected and got results. He expected results. Before he met that woman, the Samaritan woman, did he expect results? Of course. Didn't you see from that verse 4, he must needs go through Samaria. He must, an obligation, a necessity. Why must he? What was the implication? That woman will need to hear the message of salvation. And that woman will be expected to be born again. He expected results, and he got the result that he expected. Effective communication is not mere oratory. It requires a number of things. Number one, conversion and cleansing. That the person who is communicating the message of Christ himself should have been converted to Christ and cleansed by Christ. Number two, clear conscience without condemnation. A condemned man will lack confidence. A condemned man in his conscience will not be able to stand up and declare the word of truth forcefully and confidently. Clear conscience without condemnation. Number three, confidence of character. If you are declaring the message of Christ, you must have the confidence of character. Number four, conviction and courage. Conviction and courage. Now, when we talk about courage, courage is not just that, you know, the Pharisees are coming and they are opposing you, and then you're able to stand and you're able to withstand them. That's courage. Or that there is persecution in town and you're able to stand there, that's courage. But you know, this kind of courage to meet a stranger, a total stranger, a woman, A woman that is reminding you that Samaritans have nothing to do with the Jews, and you don't also have nothing to do with her, you shouldn't be talking to her. And if other men pass along while you are talking to her, they'll be looking at you, and knowing that this woman also had a reputation for immorality, and you are a minister, the courage to know you have a purpose and to stand there in public view and be able to keep on talking to her, that is a courage of character. You know you who you are, and you know what you're looking for, and we need that courage and conviction. Number five, consecration without compromise. We need that to communicate the message. Consecration without compromise. Number six, communion with Christ. And you need to be prayerful and commune with the Lord. Then number seven, conformity to Christ. Conformity to Christ. I pray that the Lord will make us real spokesmen, spokeswomen for the Lord, and we will communicate the message of life effectively to transform and change the lives and the destinies of people in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Pray that the Lord will make you a communicator, God's spokesman. Communicator. It's not just to appreciate Christ as communicator. It's that the Lord will give you his grace, will impart himself unto you, that you too will be able to communicate the gospel effectively, whether they are strangers or your regular congregation, whether they are friends, sympathizers, or total strangers. And that the Lord will make you humble enough to declare only his message, only Christ's message, and be a spokesman. And if you are talking to religious people, that the Lord will give you the word, the appropriate word. Or you're speaking to just a common man on the street that has no knowledge of true religion, no knowledge of the Bible, that God will make you an effective communicator to them. Or you are talking to children, or you are talking to young people, that the Lord himself will help you. Or you are talking to a crowd, pleading with them. Tell the Lord to grant you the power of an effective communicator. The power of an effective communicator. That whether you speak just two words, follow me, or you quote much from the Bible, that you'll speak with compelling authority, compelling authority, that there will be the expected appropriate response to the message. How clear are you in your purpose in communication? Clarity of purpose will help you to have clarity of speech, confidence, conviction, courage, communion with Christ, conformity to Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have shared with us. We're asking, Lord, that your spirit will take these words and impress them upon every heart, imprint them upon every heart that has heard in Jesus' name. That the strength of the Lord, the power of the Lord, the wisdom of the Lord, the skill of the Lord, the ability of the Lord will be imparted to every one of us in Jesus' name. That we, following the Lord Jesus Christ, will become confident, courageous, convincing communicators of the word in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, that as we expect change and transformation in the people we're communicating the message to, that we too will have change and transformation in the way we do your work and the way we communicate the word in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, this series of leadership studies will not leave us the way it met us. There will be a change. Profitable, practical change. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen.